Okay, so I'm going to talk about a few different things. I'm going to give you an introduction to some of the challenges that we face as we go forward in the future. I'm going to talk about the abstractions that we have in the UINTA code to get us portability. I'm then going to pull back from that and talk about a key computational kernel that's a real problem for us due to its sort of global communications pattern. I'll talk a little bit about performance, examples and challenges, and try and finish off by talking about portable performance. And just to make sure you're awake, I'm going to give you a little quiz a few slides in. Okay. So, peak computer power grows by a factor of 1,000. And we can obviously really use that to improve the science that we do, so it's very important. In the past, we've had to change our codes when we went from vector machines to kind of, sort of multiprocessor machines. And now the change is coming again, and we really have to figure out what to do. The new machines are all really rather different in many ways, and I'm going to talk about two examples in just a moment. And really, that's down to our desire to try and keep the power consumption down, and also the challenges of manufacturing at finer and finer scales. There's some real issues there. And the question I want to try and address is the one at the bottom here. What are the right abstractions for ensuring portability and performance? Okay, so what have we got at the moment? Well, we've been, and I'm guessing you've seen pictures of some of these before, maybe not. So we have a standard sort of BlueGeneQ node, 16 cores. We have the Xeon Phi with its 60-some cores and communications network. We have a Titan node with an AMD CPU and an NVIDIA GPU. And what we're moving to, well, we'll keep the CPUs in some form, especially for the sort of smaller machines. People are not going to drop those immediately. But we seem to be moving to nodes like the proposed Xeon Phi, KNL, KNH eventually. So we're talking about lots of sort of relatively simple cores with a complicated memory infrastructure around them. For GPUs, we're talking about multiple GPUs on a node with NVLink connected to certain CPUs and not others. The multiple GPUs is going to be a challenge. So these are the two, in particular, the two main machines that are coming in terms of the future systems, the Coral systems. So I know you've seen this before, but I just wanted to summarize what we've got. We've got Titan with a peak of 27 petaflops, Mira with about 10, moving to Summit, which is 8 to 10 times Titan, Aurora eventually with more than 180 petaflops, different communications networks and so on, the very different energy requirements, but all the relatively low increases in the peak power required by these machines. So this all looks very promising, and as I say, I know you've heard about this. So here's your little quiz. Okay. So we have Titan. It's got about 18.6 thousand nodes. Summit's going to have 3,500. We're going to hit 8 to 10x performance. So each Summit node has to have 40 to 60 times the performance of a Titan node, okay, in flops. The Titan injection bandwidth is 6.4 gigabytes per second. For Summit, the projected bandwidth is 23 gigabytes per second. Is the communications network going to handle that for a stencil calculation? That's your quiz. That's all the information you've got. So if we look at a stencil calculation, the flops are proportional to volume. Let's just assume we've got a cube. The communications are proportional to the surface area. So how much is the raw compute power is going to be 40 to 60 times, how much is the communications going to grow for a stencil calculation on that cube? So somebody at IIT did this while Jack Wells from Oak Ridge was giving a talk. So let's put a bit of competition in here. Three times. What's going to be three times more? the bandwidth requirement is going to be should be three times more than what it is here.
No, needs to be three times more of Titan.
Well, this is so the bandwidth of Summit is about four times more than Titan, right? Okay. So how much more is the communications going to be for if we have we're going to hit that many flops, the roughly, for a stencil calculation, I guess the other thing is the amount of storage is going to be roughly proportional to the number of flops. Because we have, what are we talking about for the communication, for the communications volume coming out of this? How much is it going to grow?
10 to 16.
Yeah. Okay. 10 to 16, because?
Because the volume grows by, the dimension grows by 4 times. And the volume grows 64 times. So the surface will grow 1,000.
But it's actually, that's just for one, isn't it? Because it's roughly 4 cubed. So there's 6 of those all together, right? So there's a factor of 6 there as well, is that right? So there's your 2/3. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 faces. And we've got roughly 6 times. Well, this is roughly, I don't know, whatever it is. It's less than 16. So you've got something like this. So essentially, if you think about the communications volume, what it looks like is that Titan is fairly seriously under-provisioned in terms of the amount of communications. Now, this is just the injection bandwidth, so we don't really know that. And that may change. These are all works in progress. But I'm not the only person to have picked up this problem. Okay, I was going to ask you again to look at this, but you can see, maybe we don't need to go through this. If you look at the new generations of machines based on the Xeon Phi, roughly speaking, we've got something like 48 cores now, 48,000 nodes with 16 cores, 10 petaflops. If you look at Theta with its relatively small number of nodes with up to maybe 72 cores. Nobody's saying exactly. That's the latest I got off the net. And this performance figure, then each Theta core has to be 3 or 4 times faster than a Mira core. Same with Aurora. You've got about 4 times the number of 4x of cores and 18 times the performance on it. And so each core has to be 3 or 4 times faster than a Mira core. So right now, what you're doing is seeing this sort of performance improvement on the Stampede machine, for example, with the full heavyweight Xeon cores on that machine. If these cores are not that much faster than the present Xeon Phi cores, then vectorization, I guess, is going to deliver some of that, and that might be a problem. On the other hand, the network seems to be a bit stronger on this machine, as far as one can tell, than the Titan machine. Two very different machines, one of them with a very large number of cores, a large number of nodes, one of them with relatively few nodes, very, very powerful nodes. We have to figure out how to program these with the same code. Okay. So what are the abstractions? Well, the point of this talk is to try and suggest, and it follows on from the talk this morning by Jack Nongara, that sort of directed acyclic graph task-based approaches might be one way of doing this. At the same time, we need a programming model for general sort of multi-physics, multi-scale applications. We need a runtime system. I'm going to say that, and following on from what Anshu said this morning, I'm going to say that we need a low-level portability layer. So again, I'm going to mention COCOS. And I'm going to say that really the other alternative is to have a domain-specific language to drive the problem definition at a very high level and to automatically map down onto these different architectures. So the different pieces of this are, I'm going to talk in general about the task-based approach. I'm going to show you what the UINTA programming model is, talk about the runtime system, mention COCOS, and maybe mention the NIBO and Wasatch domain-specific language that we have at UTAR. As with the other talks this morning, if you have any questions, just please yell out. Okay, so why tasks? Well, you heard this morning to a certain extent, so I'll give you a slightly a similar but also slightly different explanation in the sense that the key thing is this abstract portable definition independent of execution. You write the problem in such a way that that indicates that you don't really know where it's going to be executed, where the code is going to be executed, or how, or even on which processor necessarily. The real important idea here is over decomposition, in that you have to have work to keep everything busy because of delays in communications or execution, if cores are running slowly for whatever reason. The same approach also allows replication of execution and allows you to start dealing with fault tolerance in some sense. You can run copies of tasks elsewhere, you can run tasks on coarser meshes elsewhere. You can migrate tasks to allow varying workloads to be addressed. The really hard problems that we have to address over the next decade, I think, are ones to do with multi-scale. And in multi-scale problems, you might want to link together a number of different scales in some way, if you can. Link together a continuum code with coarse-grained molecular dynamics, maybe even some kind of ab initio code. Possibly. How we do this, we don't really know. We can get performance through a combination of the runtime system and these abstract machine layers. So that's the key feature. So let's talk about Uinta, which is the code that I'm associated with at the moment. I want to say something about portability and scalability, first of all. Before I do that, I just want to talk about the people who have actually done the work and say something about the origins of the code. Uinta goes back to 1998. The design was really visionary. This is Steve Parker. He should have been aware of what was going on with Charm++, but out there in the deserts of Utah, he wasn't. And so he just did something on his own, building on SkiRun. And got pretty good scalability, up to about 1,000 cores, fixed execution patterns. From about 2008 onwards, Steve decided he was going to be an executive at NVIDIA and handed over his office and his code to me, in a manner of speaking. And what we did was we decided to take the software onto the sort of next level by using different approaches, and partly motivated by the exascale reports that were coming out at the time that said this was a good method. So the people who did this, the two key people who moved us along in terms of scalability were Qingyu Meng and Justin Lutyens. John Schmidt was responsible for the releases, Todd Harms, a mechanical engineer. Jacqueline Beckvermitt did some really interesting work on an application that I'm not going to mention, but that application pushed us very hard for almost 6 years, in fact. And then at the moment, we've got a DOE PSAP center and the number of people working on that. One of them, John Holman, is here somewhere, hiding at the back. So he's working on the Xeon Phi. Alan Humphrey has been working on the GPUs. Dan Sunderland is one of the COCOS developers who's decided that he wants a PhD, so he's hanging out in our lab at the moment. And we have an NSF project that funds Brad Peterson, who's also been working on the GPU, and Nan and Harish, who are working on different aspects of optimizing the runtime system. So that's the sort of background. Those are the people who are doing the work. The key thing that we have is an applications model, an applications code layer that sits on top of a sort of general programming model and generates a task graph. So we compile that task graph. We then execute the task graph in an adaptive fashion. There's a simulation controller, scheduler, load balancer, and so on. We're starting to use Valerio Piscucci's PIDX approach for I/O, Visit for visualization, as people have talked about here. Again, there's a Uinta reader in Visit. The COCOS intermediate layer offers a way of dealing with legacy code and automatically mapping it onto GPUs, CPUs, and Xeon Phis. But we're only really just starting to use this, but we think it's very important. The layered approach is important because some of these applications components haven't changed as we've gone from 600 to 600,000 cores. So this enables the applications code to stay as it is. That may or may not be a good thing because it may not have been written terribly efficiently sometimes. And that matters for performance. Basically, in terms of the sorts of methods that we use, we're using a whole number of, well, three main codes, really. ICE is a kind of finite volume flow code. NPM is a kind of version of PIC for solids that's very similar to the code that Bill Tang just talked about, and all his comments on scalability and performance kind of apply to this as well. Arches is a combustion code that we're using for our big combustion simulations that has all kinds of things in that I'm going to talk about later. In terms of using mesh refinement, we use sort of uniform refinement of tiles. If any sort of mesh element is marked for refinement, we just immediately refine it. Patch-based decomposition. We have dynamic load balancing, profiling and forecasting. So we use a kind of approach that, well, we've tried all sorts of different things, but this is really a sort of time series analysis type approach that uses a combination of what we expect to happen and what we observe. We use parallel space filling curves for load balancing. We load balance at the nodal level, not at the core level anymore, because it's just a lot easier for very complex applications. In terms of the programming model, the programming model is really easy. The next slide shows an example of it, but each task defines its computation with the required outputs and inputs. You don't explicitly define the communications. There's no MPI in the user code. The users just say what they want from a data warehouse, which tasks need to execute before each other, and what goes back into the data warehouse. Uinter kind of does all the rest, creates a task graph for each computational mesh patch. Each mesh patch has its own task graph. Communications automatically overlap with computation, and we execute this task graph in an adaptive fashion. We have one task graph for each of the mesh nodes. The task graphs are often quite simple. Here's part of the ICE task graph. It's not that complicated. So the question is, how can we get scaling with task graphs as simple as that? I will show you. Okay, so here's a programming model. What we've got is a very simple stencil calculation. The blue block is what's owned by the patch. The green are the ghost or halo elements. They kind of come in off the network because the dependencies are specified automatically, so they're brought in. And then what we do is the task just basically says, get me the old solution, U old, and the halo elements, and then the calculation is just U new equals U old plus dt times some function of the old and new, the old solution and the halo elements, sort of standard stencil type calculation, and then we put new back into the new data warehouse. And that's a sort of model for all of the calculations that take place. Obviously, they're all much more complicated than that, but that gives you some idea of the relatively simple programming model that's employed in this approach. What does a runtime system do? Well, the runtime system does all these things like, well, take the initial XML input files and the simulation component, generate the task graph, do the dependency analysis, schedule the tasks, figure out whether checkpointing is needed, look for load imbalances if it is a rebalance of tasks, look for remeshing if remeshing is needed, regrid, and go right through the process again, creating the task graph and so on. So that's a very simplified view of what goes on, but the simulation component essentially sits outside of that. The linear solver sits outside of that, but we do go off and archive data and output data and so on, and we do checkpointing and all the other things that you'd expect to see. So that's what goes on in terms of the kind of system level of the runtime system. But now we have to talk about what happens on each node. So here's what happens on a node. We have, well, you've already seen the data warehouse, but now we have a bunch of CPU cores which independently go and grab tasks, get data from the data warehouse. The MPI interface to the network is done through the data warehouse. The GPUs or Xeon Phis have their own data warehouses. There's some very clever stuff here, which is a talk all on its own about how we achieve this. I'll hint at some of this later, and it involves things like prefetching and so on. Down here, we have a bunch of sort of task queues, which essentially tell us which tasks are ready. And then once tasks are ready, the CPUs or the GPUs can pick off either the CPU tasks or the GPU tasks and execute them. So we keep a localized task graph for each patch. There's no global task graph anywhere in this. And we sort of schedule objects according to some very simple heuristics about how to get performance. So that's the basic idea. Now, I showed you the task graph, and if you look at it, it's pretty simple. You know, it's almost linear. So one of the challenges is that you could say, well, how do you get scalability and performance with very simple task graphs like that? Because there doesn't appear to be as much parallelism as there were in the huge task graphs that Jack Dongara showed, which are much, much finer in scale as well. So what we do is the following. We have a number of patches on each node. Each patch has its own task graph. The halos or ghost cell connections between the patches are essentially connections between the task graphs. And we view this as a kind of task soup overall, in the sense that all these tasks on all the different patches are available for execution on, in this case, a kind of multi-core node. So we don't know where each task will execute. We don't know which core it will execute on. So this raises some interesting issues about making sure that the memory is pinned to the core, for example, and it's very difficult for us to do that. On the other hand, we can keep things going because of this, because if we can run with less patches than we have CPUs, for example. We can run with ideally we don't want to do that because we don't get scalability, but we have got results at very large scale where we've done that. So this is not a single graph. The more things you throw into this mix, the easier it gets, which runs sort of counter to many other situations in which when you make things more complicated, it gets harder and harder to make sure you keep everything busy. Now, I was asked to talk about portability and performance, and so I'm going to show you what happens when we port these task graphs onto three different architectures. So what we've got here is three sort of plots, one for Titan, one for Stampede, and one for Mira. And we've heard about these different architectures already, so I won't go over them. What we would have here is how the task graphs execute out of order in the approach that we use. So the blue line represents task 500 executing in task slot 500, for example. So that's the sort of in-order execution you can think of as the blue line. Now, the green crosses are when the task's actually executed. So here, task about 800 executed as task about 100. And here, task 500 executed as task 1100. So this one executed very late, this one executed very early. And what you see, if you look at these three different pictures, is that they are very slightly different. So we don't get the same execution order, and you wouldn't expect that because the three systems have three very different communications networks. And the other question you would ask is you should say, well, okay, why are there more late tasks than early ones? Well, if you have tasks 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, if you execute task 4 early, then 2 and 3 are executed late, so that's why the distributions are skewed. So how do we get scalability? Well, there are a number of steps that we've taken. We have one MPI process per multi-core node. So for some applications, that puts the memory down to less than 10% of what was previously used for 100,000 plus cores. We are continually rewriting the runtime system, finding bugs in it, improving it, making it work better on different systems. We use optimal patch sizes. So here, this graph on the right shows you the trade-off on an old machine. What we're looking at is a total execution time, and you can see it's sort of minimized with a patch size of about 12 cubed on this machine. And what's happening is that we've got the task wait time goes up as the patches get coarser, but basically the scheduling time here sort of goes down as we get more patches, and also the regridding time and copy data goes down as we get more patches. So we're trading off these different the cost of these different pieces of overhead. The key thing, actually, is to prioritize a task with the most external communications, as well as using out-of-order execution. And so what you're seeing here is that if we have this most messages as a criterion for execution, you see the queue length is longer, so there are more tasks waiting to execute. The wait time is a lot shorter, and the overall execution time for this example is a fraction of what it might be if we used random execution of tasks. So these heuristics, as you might call them, are very, very important. Well, does this work? Well, you've seen a lot of scaling today for different codes on different architectures, and you're seeing the same thing here. This is a fluid structure interaction example. It's a blob of material moving through a fluid with an adaptive mesh around the blob. And what you're seeing here is scaling on, this is on Mira, running out to the full extent of Mira. Off a little bit at the end, but still pretty good. This is Blue Waters, you see the performance is quite a bit better because of the faster cores. And here we have Mira with a coarser resolution and just the CPU cores on Titan, again with this coarser resolution. Fluid structure interaction with an adaptive mesh, and we have a whole bunch of results like this. But that's sort of old work. What are we trying to do now? Well, our motivating problem is an genuinely exascale problem, I believe. And because it is, NNSA was nice enough to give us a center to attack it. So we have a center, the Carbon Capture Multidisciplinary Simulation Center, the PI is Phil Smith, who's been working in combustion for a long time. Even the university president is involved. He's a coal guy originally, so and he helps us with all sorts of things. We have a computer science activity, a predictive modeling activity, an uncertainty quantification activity, and here are some of the faculty who are involved in this. James Sutherland and Matt Mike are responsible for the DSL work. Valerio Pascucci is leading the IO work with PIDX. Chuck Hansen leads the VIS work. We have an industrial partner, Alstom, who were a French company but have now been just bought by GE, and working with Berkeley and BYU under NNSA to do this. So the problem that we're interested in is clean coal boilers. And you say clean coal boiler and people think of something that might fit in their basement. These are a little bit bigger than that. So here's one, and here's the Statue of Liberty. It's about 92 meters tall, this thing. Turbulent combustion. What happens is that pulverized coal and oxygen are injected from the corners of this thing. This is the Alstom gigawatt equivalent twin fireball boiler, as it's called. There are two of these, injection of fuel into the corners of these. It's about 1,000. To deal with this, we really need to go down to a millimeter grid resolution, which is about 10 to the 12 or 10 to the 13 cells, 10 to the 14 variables maybe. It's about 1,000 times larger than what we can solve today. To do it properly, we can model it today. Here's an example of it running at present, but we have a long ways to go to get to be able to do design on this. So essentially, the problem with it is that radiation is the dominant mode of heat transfer. And well, here's a schematic of the mesh, and here's an actual experimental image, and so on, and here's what's going on in terms of the injection of fuel and air in the corners and so on. It has coal particles, soot, it has all kinds of, we have to deal with reflections, we have deposits on the walls. It's a very nasty turbulent combustion problem. Traditional sort of Reynolds average Navier-Stokes approaches don't work too well. Our friends in the Institute for Clean and Secure Energy have gone to large eddy simulation to deal with this, as they think that it's sort of like DNS for modeling these coal simulations. We're using a sort of high-order finite volume method, standard mass momentum energy conservation, the sort of LES closure. The chemistry sort of done in tabulated form. There are some issues to do with particle methods. The discrete quadrature method of moments is to do with how they handle the particles. Same time, we're trying to do uncertainty quantification, so the plot on the right there shows red is experiments, blue is computations, and green is consistent results. So it's more like a consistency approach to uncertainty quantification. A couple of things about the model that make it kind of tricky. Low Mach number approximation means that we have a pressure Poisson solve with up to 10 to 12 variables when we get there. Radiation, they have been using the discrete ordinates method, which involves massive solves. We're now trying to switch to ray tracing, which we think, and I'll show you, can work very well in parallel. There's a plot here of the breakdown of the CPU costs, and you can see that roughly, though, well, the pressure solve's not too bad. The discrete quadrature treatment of particles is about the same as the pressure solve, but the real killer is the cost of radiation. So we need to figure out how to deal with that. Before we get there, we'll talk about how we deal with the kind of the solver side. Here's a simple model problem, low Mach number approximation. We have a pressure Poisson equation to solve, given by this thing here. There were some people talking about hyper earlier. Well, we use hyper. This comes out of Lawrence Livermore. Really nice code. Preconditioned conduit gradients on regular mesh patches. We have a multi-grid preconditioner. A few tricks. This result, I cannot explain at the moment properly, because we found before we had to go to one MPI process per node. John Schmidt was trying to get some scalability results, and he managed to run this out to 512,000 cores on Mira with one MPI process per core, not per node. And here's the scaling, the weak scaling of the overall calculation, and here's the weak scaling of Hyper that we got. We're very, very pleased with this result. I wish I understood more about what was going on with it. I think that our memory usage is just so low that we can actually get away with one MPI process. We have pretty fine patches, 20 cubed on one per MPI process, which is, I think, why it works. So to sort of summarize portability, a couple of things. We have lots of different applications. We have users all over the world running this code on many different machines. It runs on everything from people's laptops up to machines like Mira and Titan and so on. We've run on Blue Waters, as I showed you. Vulcan and Mira are our main production machines. Vulcan is important for us because it's on the NNSA side and we get reasonable access to it. We've also run on a variety of other Crays. We've run on some of the DoD machines through our Army work. And we run on the Stampede machine. It was easy to port to the Xeon Phis. Getting performance has been an absolute disaster on that machine. So let's sort of break away from portability. Portability for sure, performance not so much. Let's talk about radiation. As I showed you before, it uses about half the runtime. Radiation is nasty. Anybody want to tell me why radiation's nasty? It's one of the hardest computational problems, I think. How many people solve problems with radiation in?
It's a volume-based thing.
It's a volume-based thing? No, I can deal with volume-based things. You want to offer a guess? Go on.
So to model it, you need every point to see every other point.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So how are we going to do this? Well, lots of codes, if we do ray tracing, follow rays around, or if you solve a system of equations, that will also give you that global connectivity. So how do we deal with this issue of every point seeing every other point? Well, we don't actually have to have every other point to see every other point quite. We do and we don't. So what's the equation? Well, the equation is basically we have a sort of energy equation. And one of the source terms for that comes from radiation. And in order to compute that, we essentially, without going into the detail of this too much, have to do a summation over the number of rays, over the intensities of the incoming rays. Okay? So this is how the sort of radiative sources are fed back into the sort of main CFD calculation. So really, it's the calculation of this term that's the problem. And we have to be able to understand what the contribution of all these rays is at any point in the domain. So this goes back to your comment about having to see every point in the domain. But we're not going to do it like that quite, because what we're going to do is we're going to cheat. And the way that we're going to cheat is we're going to replicate the geometry. So here's our ray bouncing around the domain. And there are a bunch of sort of temperature and absorption and scattering coefficients for each of the cells. And they essentially tell us where the rays are going to go. So the alternative way of approaching this calculation is to say, let's replicate the geometry, and let's replicate the coefficients that tell us what happens on that geometry, and let's break down the ray tracing calculation into a series of local calculations. Once we do that, what we have to do then is to, at the end of that step, is to transfer back the combined, we actually don't have to transfer back the flux information, but we have to transfer back this information so that there are copies of this stored on all the different nodes. In order to make that tractable, what we do is use a mesh refinement approach and basically use a coarse mesh on these for the radiation calculation and also for the sort of for transferring the information. So each node has a sort of has its own fine mesh, but only a coarse representation of what's around it, plus or minus however many halos we want to put in there. So to recap, what we're doing is we're essentially using an AMR approach to the radiation. So So here's our rig going out from this sort of fine element into the coarse mesh. And we're just transferring back the information that we need to do local ray tracing at any stage using mesh refinement. And we can do an analysis of this. We can analyze how much communication there is, what the effects of different strategies are, and so on, to basically make sure that we keep the communications costs down and make sure that the calculation as a whole scales. This has proved spectacularly successful. Alan Humphrey did a wonderful job on this. Well, actually, Alan and Dan both worked on this, and Todd Harmon as well. So what happened here, what we've got here are three scaling studies, strong scaling, out to 16,384 GPUs on Titan for this calculation. Well, you'd expect ray tracing to go well on a GPU. I mean, that's what they're designed for originally. But it was the communications piece of this that actually scaled very well because of the use of mesh refinement. I've got similar results for all the CPUs on Titan. That works well too. And you can see on those that we're actually, the trade-off between communication and computation is quite a sensitive one, but it's one that we can tune by this mesh refinement approach. Okay, so this is great news for the GPU. What happens if we go to Xeon Phi? This is the work that John Holman has done, and you can talk in length with him about it, as I'm sure he'll be only too glad to tell you about the challenges of working on the Xeon Phi. The bad news is that two Xeon E5s outperform one Xeon Phi by 40%, despite a huge amount of effort to do all sorts of things. Sort of working with the mesh decomposition helped performance. John tried different thread placement strategies. The caches matter. Simple vectorization approaches fail. We have an Intel Center. The guy who's our most enthusiastic Intel person said, "Try this, try this." We tried them all. It didn't make any difference. You know, so there really has to be a complete overhaul. And, you know, there is some progress. There was a 1.5 times speed up by changing the data access mechanisms that John found just recently. But the bad news is that the conservation of complexity applies to these accelerators. You either pay a heavy price with the GPUs by going to CUDA or something that translates into CUDA and sort of deal with the complexity up front. Or with the Xeon Phis, you port your code with absolute ease and then go through hell trying to get it to work. There's no easy solution right now, except maybe using something like a domain-specific language.
You think that's true of the next generation?
You tell me. You guys know more about it than I do. You're just about to spend $200 million on it. I would love to see what your performance targets are, because I think it's just not clear that, I mean, I hope it's true, and it ought to be possible, but we'll see. We'll see. I just don't know at this moment in time.
Another different architecture.
Well, I'm sure it is a different architecture, and that's what, you know, I mean, that's what we're hoping for, actually. And so I'm not, you know, it'd be very foolish to say something's not going to happen on the basis of such limited information. There was a question at the back.
Curious, for the Monte Carlo ray tracing, I'm curious, it sounds like a stochastic approach. Could you do more of a method of characteristics approach to radiation transport?
Well, you could, I mean, but this seems to actually, I mean, as long as you use something that was ray-based in this fashion, you could get good performance. Now, what you do in terms of the sampling is an interesting issue. You could, I mean, students of Phil Smith's have actually looked at different sampling strategies and so on. So you could use sparse grids for, you know, deciding what you do. And I should have said, actually, one thing I forgot to say, I'm sorry, is that we use reverse ray tracing. So we actually, instead of just pushing rays out, we kind of trace them backwards. And that helps us because it means that in any one place, you connect all the rays that are coming into that point. But yes, I mean, I think there are lots of approaches. But the key thing is actually the embarrassing parallelism of the rays themselves and the fact that we can get around the need to push those rays around the whole machine by this replication process of the relatively simple geometry that we have. Node-level performance, real applications, it's hard. There's a lot of work in computer science on easy stencils. There are relatively few flops per byte, so this is a problem. Our percentage of peak is really low. You know, 3 to 5% is good for all the reasons that you heard this morning in Jack Dongara's talk. If you work really hard, 10 to 12%, you know, the PPM code does that. I'm trying to remember, who's in the PPM code? It's a guy in Minnesota, isn't it? Paul Woodward, yeah, sorry. So this is much closer to the HPC benchmark than to LIMPAC. We have to do something about this, so low-level portability layers and domain-specific languages are going to help. I have an example of a really simple piece of an algorithm, which is basically it's how we update pressure in the ICE code. So essentially, we're trying to calculate a pressure that's halfway across the time from Tn to Tm plus 1 in here. So there's this pressure increment. There's a simple equation that defines a face-centered pressure in face-centered velocity in terms of an average velocity in this extra term. And then there's an iteration where this feeds into here, and you just go round and do this. Okay, this is the ICE algorithm for part of the pressure calculation. Easy for 1D in one material, as I've said here. 3D in multiple materials, it's the code is more problematic, and that's the issue. The way that this is done is that there are, each node has its own loop length, essentially, while you test for convergence. Well, you can fix that. There are ways of doing that. There are calls to a couple of functions inside this task. There are 11 loops over the number of materials and about 350 lines of robust C++, including a lot of checking and making sure that quantities stay physical. And to get this to actually be much more efficient, it starts to become more of an undertaking than one might think. It involves a real rewrite. Okay, we did such a rewrite, and for different problem sizes, going up from 50 cubed to 128 cubed, there are some execution times on CPUs with 12 patches and threads, GPUs with 12 patches, the performance improvement wasn't that great if you look at these numbers. If you go to one large patch, it gets better, but the speed up's only about, you know, 2 to 2.5. And we get a significant penalty for running lots of smaller tasks on smaller arrays on a GPU. We need to reduce the GPU overhead. So this gets down to the challenge of connecting the GPU data warehouse with the main data warehouse and how we do that. Well, the kind of things that we do, we try and keep data resident on the GPU. We avoid unnecessary transfers. We basically bundle transfers together. We make sure that ghost and halo cells are easily available and so on. So that the overhead has also been brought down so that fast tasks don't have as much overhead as they used to. And what's happened here is if you go down from the 12 cores again for this particular, actually quite a large problem, it's dropped from 0.653 to 0.098. So there are some real improvements there. I'm going to skip the domain-specific language piece of this, except to say that this offers some good improvements, some automated improvements, I guess. Maybe perhaps not quite as good as we would like yet. The GPU speed up here of about 12 in this largest case is over a single core, so the GPU is only doing as well as about 12 cores, which is not what we'd expect to see. But anyway, this is work very much in progress. In the same way as we reduce the overhead for the calculations I showed you before, running on the GPU, this was the initial overhead over a very low computational task. It dwarfed the task because of the data transfer costs. Now that's down to a fraction of the computational task, and this is a work that Brad Peterson has been doing, a bit of work done by Harish Dasari. COCOS has been talked about already, so I don't need to say very much about that, except that I should say that the domain-specific language also uses C++ template metaprogramming. Some very nice results with COCOS. These are some of the original results coming from Carter Edwards and Dan Sunderland's work on a simple MD kernel. And you can see that the GPU does a lot better than the Phi, and the Xeon Phi does worse than the original Xeon, as in the other results I showed you. So the results that we got are reasonably consistent. Going to... if using COCOS, here's a bit from the work that Dan and John did as part of their class project, in fact, which was just to look at Laplace's equation using COCOS. So here's the original Uinta code, and here's the new COCOS code, not so different, pretty easy to move from this to this. This goes twice as fast as this does using COCOS on CPUs. So we kind of think COCOS is important. What I've done is I've showed you there are five abstractions. They're all important for portability scaling and for not needing to change the application's code. The most significant challenge, perhaps, is the development cost in the runtime system. We still have to tune that runtime system. What we found is that you can't develop nodal code in isolation. So if you sit there and write code on a node and say, well, this stuff is going to scale, our answer to that is, well, frankly, we don't really believe you unless you're very lucky indeed. For future portability, we want to use COCOS for the rewriting the legacy apps that we've got, the DSL for generating new code. Our investigations of these, the Xeon Phi or the mic are ongoing, and we're aiming at these future machines like Summit or Aurora. And the last point here is that there are some really even more challenging applications, I think, out there that come from multi-scale modeling, where we really have to combine things at fine scales with things at the sort of continuum scale in order to get meaningful simulation results. And there I should stop. Thank you.